Very good morning, everyone. Let us see the today topic. As we know, parasitology divided into protozoa and metazoa. Parasite which have single cell known as the protozoa. The parasite which have multicell known as the helminthus. Today we'll discuss about metazoa. Metazoa, otherwise known as the helminthus. In common language, we will call it as the worm. So today outline will be helminthology, cystodes and homeopathic approach. So at end of the class, the viewer will understand about this part. Okay. So we'll see about the basic concept of helminthus. So it divided into two types, plathy helminthus and nematodes. So the word meaning plathy means a flatworms, and this divided into two types, cystodes and trematodes. So basically, the metazoa divided into the three types, cystodes, trematodes and nematodes. There are two similarities between the cystodes and trematodes, that is the hermaphrodites. So what is that? The both male and female sexual organ present into the single parasite. Okay. So commonly the cystodes will call it as the tapeworm and trematodes call it as the flukes. So few difference and narrating. One is cystodes is segmented, the cells have segmented, where there is trematodes are non-segmented. And in case of cystodes, the gastrointestinal tract is absent. In case of trematodes, gastrointestinal tract is present but no anus. So today class will discuss about the cystodes. Okay, cystodes, as I said, the common name is worms, tapeworm. Okay, there are six tapeworm which infect the human. The number one is Tinea saginata, we will call it as a common name, we will call it as a beef tapeworm. And Tinea solium, the common name is pork tapeworm. And Echinococcus granulosus, the common name is dog tapeworm. And Diplyobotherium, it is a fish tapeworm. And Hypanolepis nana, there is a dwarf tapeworm and rat tapeworm. So out of the six, today we are going to see about the Tinea saginata and Tinea solium. Okay. If you comes for the understanding about the basic things, kingdom comes under the Animalia, subkingdom as we studied, it is comes under the Metazoa, phylum it is the Plathy helminthus, class cystodes, and order, there are two type of order, one is pseudopilidae and cyclopilidae. So what is the pseudopilidae means? The larva does not containing the sac, that means fluid. And cyclopilidae means the larva containing the sac, bladder like sac. Okay. Family, there is a Tineidae, and genus Tinea, and species Tinea saginata and Tinea solium. Okay, so today we'll understand about the 6 points. Introduction, habitat, morphology, life cycle, clinical features and diagnosis. So we'll study one by one. So introduction, the common Tinea species which affect the humans are three, that is Tinea saginata, Tinea solium and Tinea asiatica. So these two will be more important. So it's very important that Tinea solium causes 30% of epilepsy causes in many endemic places. Mostly we are unaware of this symptom. So we'll study. The human gets infection due to the fecal-oral route by ingestions. Okay. Habitat. The host is two hosts, that is a human and cattle. So human we are calling as a definitive host and cattle we are calling as a intermediate host. As we are aware of, where there is adult tapeworm will be present and sexual cycle is appearing, it is known as the definitive cycle. So human, it is a definitive host. And in the human, it lives in the small intestine, especially jejunum. In the cattle, it is an intermediate host, lives in the heart, lungs and muscles through the circulations. The morphology, as we know, all the worms have the similar morphology, ova or egg, larva and adult worm. And for our better understanding, we are dividing the adult worm into the three parts. One is head part, neck and body. The head part, it is known as the scolex. and the head part is known as the scolex, and neck and body. The body part we are otherwise known as the strobilia. And this head part again divided into the three types. One is rostellum and hook and suckers. We'll study everything in the when it comes to the adult ova. So first we'll study about the ova. This is the I'm representing in diagrammatic. I'll explain into the through a diagrammatic representation. So this is the shape. Shape will be round shape and size will be 31 to 43 micron. And it have the two type. One is the eggshell. This eggshell. This is the yellow color. This is the eggshell. It is a thin eggshell. And inside there is a. It is known as the embryophore. This is a thick layer. There are two layer. One is eggshell and another layer is the embryophore. So inside the embryophore, this inside the part we are calling as a oncospore or hexantho embryo. So what is a hexantho? Hexantho means six. So there will be six hooklet will be present. So between these two layer there is a presence of the fluid. Okay, that we are explaining. The shape is round, size is 31 to 43, eggshell is thin and color is the bile stain. As we know, embryophore means brown, thick, radically striated. So this is the one, and embryophore, oncospore and hexantho embryo. This inside the part it is known as the oncospore or hexantho embryo, and it have three pairs of hooklets. So this is the arrangement of the ova, and if you see in the microscopy, you can see this is the eggshell and inside this layer, it is known as the embryophore, and inside the embryophore, of course the hooklets is not seen. Second one, it is the larva. So larva commonly otherwise known as the bladder worm or fluid worm, and infective form of, this is the infective form of the human. There are Tinea saginata, the infective form known as the Cysticercus bovis, and Tinea solium, it is known as the Cysticercus cellulae. Okay, so we'll study. So this is the simple representation. You can see this is the larva. This larva, there is a presence of the head part will be present. So the head part will be present into the invaginator. It is sinks inside to the larva. Okay, so we'll study the basic difference. Tinea saginata, the name of the larva is known as the Cysticercus bovis. The name of the larva in the Tinea solium, it is known as the Cysticercus cellulae. And length is more or less it's similar. Fluid content is, in saginata it is the more, in solium it is less. And scolex, scolex means we have studied into the head. Head is invaginated in both the parasite, and rostellum is absent in both the parasite, and hook, it is present in case of Tinea solium, and suckers also it is present in case of Tinea solium. And very important points are, this Tinea saginata we can see in the muscles of the cattle, and Tinea solium we can see in the muscles of the pig. Okay. Now we will go for the adult form. As this is the adult form of Tinea saginata and Tinea solium, the Tinea saginata is very bigger than the Tinea solium. We will study the details. So adult form, as we are aware of that, divided into the three parts: head, neck and body. So otherwise known as the scolex, and the body part it is known as the strobilia. So this head part, it again for our understanding, we divide into the three: rostellum, hook and suckers. Okay, what is that? What is the function about it? Okay. So we'll study, as I told you, the Tinea saginata length is 5 to 10 meter, but in case of Tinea solium, it is only 2 to 5 meters, and with this 10 to 13 mm, and in case of Tinea solium 6 to 9 mm. Okay. This is the head part. Okay. I will explain through the thing. So this is the Tinea solium and this is the Tinea saginata. Tinea saginata, it is a quadrate shape, you can see the quadrate shape, and Tinea solium you can see it is a globular shape. And the neck, it is present in the head. In case of saginata, the rostellum is absent, but in case of solium, the rostellum is present, and there is a small like a hair like particles, it is known as the hook, where there is in the Tinea saginata it is absent. And suckers, these are the four suckers. Here also in the Tinea saginata also having the four suckers. So that we are dividing into the shape. As we said, the Tinea saginata is a quadrate shape, and in Tinea solium it is a globular shape. And size is larger, more than 1 mm, the head is more than 1 mm, where in case of tinea solium, the head is less than 1 mm. And rostellum is absent and tinea solium it is present. So around 20 to 30 rostellum is present. So we can call it as the nose of the parasite. So that nose will be present for the tinea solium. And hooks also present into the tinea solium. And suckers, both have 4 suckers. Okay, for the tinea saginata, otherwise known as the unarmed scolex, and tinea solium is known as the armed scolex, based on presence of the hooks. So if the hooks are absent, so we are calling as the unarmed scolex. Whether it is hooks are present in case of tinea solium, so we are calling as the armed scolex. So this is the pictures. So this is the tinea saginata. You can see the 3 suckers and there is the absence of rostellum and hooks. And this is the, here also we can see there is a 2 suckers you can see, but there is the absence of, so it is a tinea saginata. But in case of tinea solium, you can see there is a suckers and this is the rostellum along with the hook. So this is a tinea solium. Okay, the neck part. So neck is long. In case of tinea saginata, tinea solium, it is a very small. So 3 to 7 mm, more than 3 to 7 mm, it is known as the long. Okay. So the tinea saginata, narrow, fragile, both are same, but color difference. This saginata looks white opaque, but in tinea solium, it looks like a gray blue. And the important one is the body. So body, as we said, the body part, otherwise known as the strobella, it is a ribbon shape. Okay, so each body made it of different segment. So each segment we are calling as the proglottides. This is the segment. You can see the each segment. This is the one segment. So like this, so many segments will be present. So each segment, it is known as the proglottides. Okay, so it is the body arrangement is the ribbon shape. If the body having 3 type of segment, one is immature segment, mature segment and gravid segment. This is the gravid segment. Okay, so immature segment, for simple understanding, length is more than the width is more than the length. But in case of mature, width and length are equal. In case of gravid, lengths are more than the width. So this is the immature segment, this is the mature segment and this is the gravid segment. You can see the size of the segments. Okay, so we'll see about the basic about the segments. Number of the segments, number of proglottides is thousands to 2000 in case of saginata, but in case of tinea solium it is less than 1000. And posterior protuberance, it is present in case of saginata, absent in case of tinea solium. And expulsion of the segments in stool, it is appearing as a single segment. Single segment will appear into the stool, where there is the appearance is the chain arrangement. And uterus, it is more than 30, in case of tinea solium is less than 30. Ovary, two ovary without lobe, accessory lobe. In case of tinea solium, it have 3 lobes with accessory lobe. And vaginal sphincter, it is present in case of tinea saginata, it is absent in case of tinea solium. And the, as we know, it is all female and male sexual organ, it is present. Testes, it have more than 300 in case of saginata and less than 300 in case of tinea solium. Lifespan is 10 years approximately, but here it is 20 to 30 years approximately. And egg production in each segment, each proglottidis, it is 1 lakh in each segment in case of tinea saginata and 50,000 in case of tinea solium. Okay, so that's about the morphology. So let me go for the life cycle. So life cycle is very simple. The infective form of tinea saginata is the Cysticercus bovis. Infective form of tinea solium, it is known as the Cysticercus cellulae. And the source of infection is consumption of uncooked beef or meat. Host, it is definitive host is the human and intermediate host is the cattle like cow, pork, etc. And habitat, small intestine of the human, as we studied, it is present into the, especially into the upper jejunum. And lifespan, for our purpose, we divide into the two types, human life cycle and cattle life cycle. And incubation period, what is incubation period? It is affection to the human till the signs and symptom, appearance of the signs and symptom. So it will has to month to 5 years. Okay, we'll study about the brief introduction about the life cycle. One is cattle life cycle and another one is the human life cycle. Okay, now we'll study the human life cycle. So infective form of the larva, the infective form of the this parasite is known as the larva. So when this is the source of infection, when the persons are eating uncooked beef or pork, so what happens? This uncooked beef or pork containing this larva will enter to the human intestine and attach into the jejunum. And as we studied, the larva have invaginated scolex. Scolex means head. So when it comes to the human, it will become extravaginal of the scolex, and that will mature into the adult form. So adult form which liberates the egg. So as I told you, in case of saginata, 1 lakh per each day by each eggman, and in case of 50,000 by tinea solium. So this is a simple human life cycle. And we'll go for the cattle life cycle. So when the human excrete the eggs in the stool, so this will be ingested by the cattle. So that will go to the intestine of the cattle. So the as we studied, the egg containing hexanthoembryo, so the embryophore will be getting destructed and hexanthoembryo will be getting activated, that penetrates the gut wall, then reach to the cattle, circulation of the cattle. So this circulation, the circulation of the cattle, then it reaches to the right heart, then it reaches to the lungs, then reaches to the left heart, then gone to the peripheral circulation, then ultimately it reaches to the muscles. There muscles, the egg will be converted into the or mature into the larva. So this larva, again the life cycle, when the persons are eating the uncooked beef or meat, the source of infection, then human cycle will be repeated. This is a simple life cycle of the cattle. Okay, now we'll see about the clinical features. So tinea saginata causes tineasis and usually asymptomatic. Many causes are where abdominal discomfort, loss of appetite, nausea, ingestions and insomnia. So it's very, tineasis, usually it is asymptomatic. And tinea solium, you can able to identify by the two. One is the causes of cysticercosis, which produce palpable mass in the subcutaneous tissue of eye, brain and rarely in the lungs and the liver. Okay. So this neurocysticercosis is one of the common intracranial occupying lesions under epilepsy. Compared to tinea saginata, tinea solium is able to understand some of the clinical features. One is palpable mass, another one is producing the convulsion, or some of the nervous clinical features which is able to understand the persons are suffering, maybe suffering from the tinea solium with the confirmation of the diagnosis. Okay, we'll go for the diagnosis. What and all the diagnosis is useful for this parasite. So there are 6 diagnostic: in tinea saginata, stool examination, serodiagnosis, molecular methods, and biopsy, imaging, and others. So we'll study one by one in short. So stool examination, there are 2 types. One is brine flotation method, another one is cellophane tape method. So what these 2 methods help? These 2 methods helps to identification of eggs and segments, prochlorides. Okay. So what is this method? The brine flotation method. This method based on the weight of the parasite, which lighter than the solution will float or sink into the bottom. This is a simple method. So tinea saginata and tinea solium, both are non-floated ova. That means if you are putting into this solution, this will not float, it will not sink inside. So the both are, it is a non-floated ova, that means weight are less. And cellophane type method, this method based on collection of material from the perianal region through the transparent adhesive tape, and then the tape transferred to the glass slide, which may be visualized through the microscopy. Okay, the same thing, what you can see, the tinea saginata and tinea solium, you can able to identify the characteristic of egg. So you may get confusion that both ovas are similar. Then how to differentiate whether it is the tinea saginata ova and tinea solium ova? It's very simple. Okay, the tinea saginata ova is the acid for stain positive, where there is a tinea solium is a acid for negative. That means acid for, after doing acid for staining, this looks red color, then it is acid for positive, and it is looks blue color, it is known as the tinea solium. Okay, and we can see the segment also, as we told in the stool, expulsion of the single segments, proglottidis, in case of tinea saginata, expulsion in the chain arrangement or group of the segments will come out in the stool. So that is known as the tinea solium. And you can see the uterine branches also in the segment, it is more than 13, it is tinea saginata, less than 13, it is the tinea solium. Not only egg can produce segments, you can see the body strobella also, counting up strobella as we discussed in the morphology. So this, because of stool examination, you can able to identify that. Even the scolex also, we can able to identify whether it is a tinea saginata and tinea solium. Next one is serodiagnosis. Okay, serodiagnosis, for our better understanding, it is a three investigation. One is detection of the cropro antigens in the stool by ELISA. Number two is indirect heme agglutination test and indirect immunofluorescent test. Okay, we'll study first one. What is cropro antigens ELISA test? This method for detection of the cropro antigens in the stool by the ELISA. So what is that cropro antigens? Cropro antigens means any group of antigens found in the stool which present for the longer time in the fecus. So if anything enter to our body which is abnormal, it is known as the antigens. So what about any group of antigens? There is a tinea itself is the antigen. So detection of that tinea antigen in case of, that is known as the cropro antigens, and through which method? By the ELISA. So this is a simple method. Next is agglutination test. So agglutination test, what is agglutination test? Anyway, this everything I will describe about the future immunology class, but here I am giving the simple introduction. The agglutination test means it helps to identify the antigens or antibody presence or in the amount. If you are able to identify the amount of the antigen or antibody, we will call it as a titer. Okay, it divided into the two type, direct agglutination test and indirect agglutination test. So direct agglutination test, what is that? Measure the antibody against the RBC antigens. This is the direct method. So what we are doing today for in order to help for the tinea tapeworm is that we are using for the indirect agglutination test. What is indirect agglutination test? Measure the antibody against antigen coated RBC. What is antigen here? It is a tinea antigens. Okay, we'll discuss little more. So indirect heme agglutination test, this is a type of agglutination test where soluble antigens coated on the RBC, the surface of the RBC, there will be tinea antigens will be coated. So what is the end result? End result is measuring the antibody against the antigen coated RBC. So after 10 days, as we know, so any antigen comes, the antibody will be produced. So measurement of the antibody against this antigen, it is known as the indirect chemo agglutination test. So we will we will call it as a titer. Okay, so indirect, next one, it is indirect immunofluorescent test. So utilized fluorescent labeled antibody to detect the specific target antigens. So that you can see under the fluorescent microscope, under the UV light. So what we can see? Apple green color. Okay, so this is the, you can able to see the parasite, whether it is a tinea solium or tinea saginata. Okay. Next one, it is the molecular test. So molecular test, what is molecular test? Very simple, to identify the DNA sequence of the tinea. There are two type of molecular test. One is a polymerase chain reaction, another one is DNA probes. Okay, we'll study polymerase chain reaction. Here I am giving only introduction. The detailed polymerase chain reaction I will take future class, I am going to take in the immunology. Okay, what is polymerase chain reaction? The polymerase chain reaction is simple, to identify the target DNA sequence. in case of tinea, you can identify the tinea DNA sequence. Okay, so before that, what we are calling it, the name is polymerase chain reaction. Why it is polymerase chain reaction? The name denote that the polymerase means the only enzyme used in this test are DNA polymerase, and chain means three reactions occur one by one on many times, and reaction means one substance change into the other substance, known as the polymerase, known as the reaction. So polymerase chain reaction, this is the word came because of this reason. Okay, we have studied the three reaction. What is the three reaction? Here I'm giving simple understanding. One is denaturation, another one is renaturation, another one is synthesis. So what is denaturation? You know, all the DNA have double strand. So the double strand DNA separated into the two individual strand by heat. So two DNA will be separated by the heat. So afterwards, the each strand hybrid with the primer. What is the primer? The primer is used for, it is a artificial DNA sequence help to develop the DNA. So each strains hybrid with the primer, and new strains of DNA is made by the polymerase enzyme. So simple understanding is single copy of the or few copies of DNA from the clinical sample. We will take it from the clinical sample. Okay, from there we can identify the DNA of the DNA sequence. So that is a polymerase chain reaction. The DNA probe also, we can able to identify the DNA sequence of the antigens. Okay, so but this is the important one. It helps to differentiate the DNA saginate and DNA solium, as well as other identification you can able to do with the DNA probe. And biopsy, so as we know, the biopsy means removal of small piece of tissue from the living body for diagnostic or therapeutic purpose. And imaging have, first one it is the radiography. So radiography, one of the confirmative diagnosis by biopsy or FNAC of the subcutaneous nodules. This will be useful for the tinea solium, which appear as dot shaped or ellipsoidal classification in the muscles of the thigh or arms. So how it is formed? Once it is antigen comes, there will be chronic inflammation, leads to granulomatous, leads to calcified mass due to inflammatory response against the tinea solium larva. So it is very simple. It looks like a rice grain shape in the soft tissue. So you can see here in the soft tissue, you can see small calcification mass. So this is known as the rice grain calcified mass. So we can see into the tinea solium. Okay. CT scan and MRI, you can able to see dead calcified cyst, which seen as a small hypodensity with a bright central spot. Okay, so this is the same image. So you can see there is a bright spot you can see here. So this is a neurocystocercosis, which is used for the diagnosis of the tinea solium. And some of the other investigation also can be useful mainly for the tinea solium. One is anti-cysticercus antibodies in the serum or CSF by through the ELISA method, and antigen reduction in the serum by the same CSF by the ELISA method, and ocular ophthalmoscopy if the person is suffering from the eye complaints in case of tinea solium. Okay, so that's about the pathological part. And now we'll go for the homeopathic understanding. So there are some of the misconception into the homeopathic world. The pathology knowledge is not required for the homeopathic practice. The only some of the medicine knowledge is enough for the prescription of the medicines. So here the basic concept of homeopathy based on the symptomatology, but not about the study of the disease. But simple understanding, without knowing the study of the disease, how the person can identify the symptomatology. Okay. As we know, the two diagnoses important for our homeopathy. One is disease diagnosis, and next one it is person diagnosis. So person diagnosis, this will be more important than the disease diagnosis. So what is a person diagnosis? As we studied the constitution, diathesis and adaptability. Here it is genotype and phenotype. So I have explained into the neoplasia part 5. I explained about the genotype and phenotype. So please go through that in order to understand about these two. And constitution, diathesis and phenotype. Okay, this two, the disease diagnosis, combination with the person diagnosis, then we can able to identify the remedy diagnosis. So this will be easy. This, if you can able to understand this two. Okay, so what is that? If the person prescription based only on the disease diagnosis, only on the disease diagnosis, it is known as the pathological prescription. So this is not a homeopath, but still in some condition for making the palliation, this pathological prescription can be allowed. Okay, so here another homeopath, what happened? They will identify the disease diagnosis, so eliminate the disease diagnosis and identify the individualized symptom without person diagnosis. So disease diagnosis, the main purpose of knowing about disease diagnosis is this one, eliminate the diseased symptom from the patient and remaining symptom, or identify the individualized symptom without person diagnosis. Okay, if the persons are, if the homeopaths are doing, they are known as the keynote prescription. Okay, there are important another method, same, eliminate the disease symptom and identify the individualized symptom based on the person diagnosis, based on the constitution, diathesis or adaptability. So this will helps to help. So what is that? That will helps to identify the totality of the symptom. So that will tell about the person individualization. Okay, as the Hahnemann explained it to the aphorism 7 and 18. So most we have to go for this method in order to know the remedy diagnosis proper. Okay, here I am mentioning some of the few homeopathic medicines. Okay, first one, it is cuprum, oxidatum, nigrum, there is a 1x. So the boric is given, it helps for all kind of worm including tapeworm and trichinosis. It is the nothing but it is a pathological prescription. And Felix mass, one of the common remedy used for the tapeworm. It is mostly the signs and symptom. If you read about the Felix mass, it is my opinion, it is good for the tinea saginata. So what is it? So it is a insomnia cases and torpid inflammation of the lymphatic glands, everything comes under the tinea saginata. It's a good medicine for tinea saginata. And granatum, it helps for the tinea solium. Why I come to the conclusion? Because the involvement of the nervous system, nervous system involvement, convulsion, vertigo, etc. And kusho, this is the helps for the expulsion of the tapeworm with cardiac symptom, subdelirium and collapse, etc. So this also we can take it as a pathological prescription. And santoninum, so here we have to understand the boric is written, it is useful for the nematodes but not in the cystodes. Is written, it is useful for the ascariasis and hookworm, not in the tapeworm. So we have to know this understanding, how we can understand by the knowledge of pathology. So nematodes but not cystodes. So but in case of santoninum, the eye and urinary symptoms are very common. And sabadilla, it is mainly useful for the tapeworm. So the tapeworm will be traveling to everything. So what is signs and symptom? Allergy and reflux symptom will be appearing into the patient, especially the lymphomania and convulsion. So it is mainly maybe useful for the tinea solium. So this is not, there are so many remedy, but this is not the some remedy which commonly used for the tapeworm. So that's about the tapeworm part 1. So next class we'll go for the Echinococcus granulosis. Thank you.